the best bits of lunacy is dealing with it and throws at you. Fishing in this? We'd be looking for a few mere forces before we called it a day. This job is nae like ordinary jobs, it's mere life. One minute it can be kind to you and the next minute it can try and destroy you.
I think I would hate to be away from the harbour and away from MD. It's speaking to me about fish, because it just brings everything back.
August that year, I was 17, so I was just starting to drive, because I remember I'd passed my driving test for a gun, driving down to Cumberland for the naming ceremony. She looked really nice when she came out of shed, got a bit of sunlight on her. It was brilliant. And you just felt that there was a lot more exciting times to come, Ken.
Fishing operation and shooting. Got the one net up here. The codeine is dropped from aft. I work these for the wheelhouse. Last thing you want to do is get snagged and dragged. That's the simple part of it. After 5 hours towing, the net is hauled aboard, grabbed using this power block into this point here. A few turns in this capstan, dog rope Gilson wire, click it in, signal, slack back. Wire comes tight, bag slacked, fish go up forward to the hopper. A guy standing here, maybe a guy standing here, taking your knife, which should be sharp, up, flick open, collect the guts like that. The longest I've stood here and gutted has maybe been 15, 16 hours. A sing song helps pass the time. A lot of good times down here. A lot of good times.
I think 24-year-old Xander West is son of Sandy West and at least the fifth generation of his family to go to the fishing. Their boat, the Steadfast, works out of Fraserburgh, the town at the heart of the crisis facing the UK's whitefish fleet.
No apple.
See, that's how you doffed up now, eh?
Never go.
Be a little dance. When I was little, we used to hear a receiver in the house. You couldn't talk back, but my dad talked every night, 10 o'clock. We'd sit and we'd be on this receiver and he would tell us how the day's news, which was usually seeing whales, I've seen this, I've seen that. And then it would be, good night, love ya, Fiona, Xander, Kenna, Mom. And that'd be about 10 o'clock every night, innit? I think that's missing for life nowadays, is it? That little, like, romantic things. Ken? I would like nothing better than Donnie to be like I was and work with me, because I have enjoyed every single minute working with my dad.
It is the most dangerous job in Britain, and yet young men are still drawn to the excitement and rewards that lured their fathers and grandfathers to the hunting grounds at sea.
You're getting fish, it's good. Problem is, when you don't get fish.
But the tide has turned. Waters that were once British are now European, and the common fisheries policy rules the waves. The fishermen can't stomach it.
It's Brussels' job to stop us catching fish, but it's our job to catch fish. If we don't catch fish, we don't get paid. Simple.
They have found their industry is regarded by our politicians as having little value as a bargaining chip in Brussels. Whilst other nations prize this natural resource, here, since joining Europe, our fishermen believe they are being sacrificed through government apathy. They're fighting for survival. The call to arms was answered by the wives of two Fraserburgh fishermen. On the 5th of November 2002, Carol MacDonald and Morag Ritchie decided to act. The Cod Crusaders were born.
I did basically say to Morag, you know, I think something should be done about it. And obviously, we're husbands tapped into this, and they'd say, oh, right, and you guys are going to be the ones that's going to do it.
They started laughing, and the more they laughed at us, the more determined we got. So next morning we got up, and that's when we started printing out the petition, and that's where we set off from.
Within a week, with a 9,000-signature petition, they were at the door of 10 Downing Street. 4 weeks later, a rally in Edinburgh carried a staggering 49,000 signatures to the Scottish Parliament. And just days later, they were in Brussels, confronting the European Fisheries Minister, Franz Fischler.
Yeah, I will do that. I promise you.
We're trying to save the way of life. Fraserburgh community life. If you remove an industry, especially from the likes of Fraserburgh, it's so highly dependent on the fishing, you're ripping the heart out of the whole community. You're actually taking the heritage and history also away from a community, which is what we're trying to preserve.
After the savage decommissioning in 2002, the UK government wants to destroy a further 69 boats. They target the white fish sector, particularly the newer, larger boats like Sandy's Steadfast. The banks, sensing a crisis in their massive investments, are only too willing to seize the chance to get out. Sandy and many other skippers may lose their boats, whether they like it or not.
We're just under the wheelhouse here. And if you come through this way, we go into the mess deck galley, like a sort of recreation room as well. The whole lot's been refurbished, and it's such a shame, really, isn't it? To get it all broken up. One of the worst aspects of it is looking at this vessel and how well I've kept this vessel, and 6.5-year-old getting broken up. It is, to me, a criminal act.
To watch her come for a keel, to fetch her whiz, and popping up and doing to Cumberland to see a finished product, and then a few years later, knowing she's just about to get stripped back down to the keels, it's enough to mark you a bit sick, to tell you the truth.
The Scottish Executive has set aside £40 million for decommissioning. Generous though this seems, it is estimated that around 80% of the money will go straight to the banks to pay off their loans.
Skippers are actually being pushed up against the wall. They've got no choice, they have to take it if the banks are pushing them there. It's the crews that I actually feel sorry for. All they get at the end of the day, if the vessel that they're on is decommissioned, is basically, you know, sorry guys, roll your gear, that's it. They don't even get, you know, as much as a thank you. They won't get a payoff. It's so heartbreaking.
Carol's husband, Malcolm, is crewman on a whitefish trawler. Though sceptical of the campaign, he's come to terms with the public profile.
I can't really complain. No, I know I get much slagged about it, not at all. Somebody slags me, they'll get a headbutt. The real McCoy. God. Green and white, dynamite.
But for Malcolm, the days of big cod catches and good prices are a thing of the past.
Years ago, maybe you got a buzz, there's just no fun left in the job. This being 2003, I would say I'd make about, if I'm lucky, I'd make 18,000-19,000, I would say, if I'm lucky. 10 years ago, you'd hundreds of boats, right? He's marking me our money 10 years ago, and there was thousands of boxes getting landed. That days is long gone. Long gone.
I like to come in between 5 and 6 a.m. In order to get my 2 hours in so I can get home to put my son to school. 2 years ago, I took it on purely because it was a wee bit of pin money. But, I mean, I've become really highly dependent and it pays my bills because my husband's taken a drop of wages. The secret is you need to remember exactly where you come from, where your roots are. And I'm just a pretty normal person. I mean, don't get me wrong, I mean, I don't like cleaning up everyone else's, you know, dirt, but, I mean, the money is clean at the end of the week. The money is clean. You don't know what tomorrow brings.
April 2003. The Crusaders decide to advance their campaign on a new front. Courted by the SNP, Carol stands for a seat on her local council.
Release Fraserburgh's potential on the 1st of May.
Vote SNP!
You could say vote McDonald all the way.
Release Fraserburgh's potential on the 1st of May. Vote McDonald and you'll be all the way.
That was a good one.
If I'm unsuccessful, I mean, I've nothing to lose.
Thanks very much.
Because personally, my fight will continue through the Cod Crusaders in order for my community to have some sort of survival rate.
Thanks. Ta-da. Ta-da. Huh?
Early next morning in Fraserburgh's fish market, there's mixed support for the industry's future.
19 pound USD!
Of course it's worth fighting for. Of course it's worth fighting for.
19 pound a collie!
It's too late.
Raising your voice at political level, you know, and standing for what you believe is surely never a pointless exercise, no.
And 60 pound a pair of megrims, hold on!
It's nothing to do with politics for me. I'll just get a living out of it. If it goes doing it, it goes doing it.
Ladies and gentlemen, the result in Ward 11. Carol MacDonald, Scottish National Party.
Hiya, honey, Flake. Flake,
who'd you get on?
475.
Oh, I've lost it.
You lost?
Aye, 154 votes. I lost it by.
Are you all right?
I am fine. I am not too disappointed, Ken. The fight will go on through the Cod Crusaders. It's as simple as that.
Oh, God. Top.
Oh, no.
Aye. No. Look, even your T-shirt now is all cluttered.
It finishes.
Well, hang on in and tuck it down to me.
Undaunted by the defeat, the Crusaders return to their favoured ground, the media.
To really have some faith in the industry, because at the end of the day, we actually have to inject some positivity into this bad situation.
Their greatest strength is their ability to attract press coverage of the crisis.
How can I help you? You want a story, are you?
Actually, at the point of the transitional ladies.
Bradshaw. Once we advised him about what we
from publicity comes credibility. They gain access to government ministers and contribute to Number 10's report on the industry. All this on a campaign funded by themselves with contributions from the industry and local supporters.
Yeah. We've realised that we've got capabilities that we didn't realise we had before.
They admitted they're not getting true readings.
There's more to life than being a wife and a mother, and although I was quite happy with that 6 months ago. So let's put them to some use. We've had to sacrifice quite a lot in order to forefront this campaign. I mean, I've got 3 kids and I've got a grandchild. I mean, Morag's got 7 kids.
A message from my husband.
We're still there when the important times, you know, meal times and bed times. But the quality time with our kids is not the same anymore.
July. The decommissioning list is published. And Sandy's boat, the Steadfast, is on it. He's unimpressed with the offer, but his bank is pressing him to accept. He has a month to decide.
This boat approximately costs 1.35 million. What they're offering and decommission is just absolutely ridiculous. It's a mere pittance. I would come out of this with nothing if I decommissioned my boat.
His bank will take all of the money plus the value of his fish quota. Tougher still, the deal even requires him to price the breaking up of his own boat. Within days, two Danish shipwrecking yards are in town hunting for business.
Even if it's 21 or 22 ton.
They aim to profit by selling on all reusable parts.
It's a 5,000.
Yeah.
Aye.
It is.
So you're happy with that then?
Absolutely. 69 boats are to be scrapped. And we hope to get 30 or 35 boats. We don't want too many because we also have to sell the equipment, so we're only going for the best. You had a 3508, huh?
35.
Main engine.
3512.
A 3512. Aye. Some of the skippers get mad, almost tell us to fog off the boat, so to speak, because it's a really tension time and they cannot make up their mind about the decommissioning. And then there was
The gyro compass.
Okay.
You've got that one as well?
Yeah.
Good. Okay.
And I got everything.
Fine.
I needed to know.
My hopes for the future, I think's the same as most fishermen, is that we can go on. Keep doing what the family's done for years. That's catch fish.
The West family has built each boat mindful of the next generation. The crew of the fourth Steadfast are Sandy's two sons, a nephew, as well as a cook loyal to the boat for 21 years. Sandy stays ashore to weigh up the future. For years, his boys have been looking forward to taking over the family business.
There's a fierce sense of pride every time you take a boat out of harbour. It probably even more so when your dad's watching you do it.
It's strange. Possibly could be the last trip with the boat. We don't know. It's very sad to see.
For every man at sea, there are at least five or six people ashore working in the support industries.
Going out the door here. The rest of Europe is building new super trawlers, and we're being demised deliberately.
There must be a hidden agenda for the Scottish fleet. They want us out, and the only way they want us out is because we're one of the richest fishing grounds there is.
We could become the first island in the history of the world that doesn't even have a fishing industry. It's not because of conservation, it's about accommodation of the Spanish and the European fleet. We're being sacrificed on the altar of Euro Union.
Around the harbour here, it's basically all little industries. There's no big ones at all. There's the electrical engineers, which is us, painter, plumber, the hydraulic man, can't remember the ball, but there's loads. This year alone, again, we reckon 400, maybe 500 jobs ashore will be lost by this decommissioning. There's got to be a point that things is going to collapse.
Their fears are based on previous decommissioning rounds, when they received no compensation and losses ran into hundreds of thousands of pounds.
This has been a shoe shop for 20 years. Nobody has confidence in the fishing. Nobody has confidence in the town. The new company just doesn't have the confidence to sign a long-term lease. Just nobody seems to have the get up and go. Well, they do. Actually, they do. The cod crusaders are doing quite a good job. Your heart and soul goes into the shop. It becomes you and you become it. And it's gone. Gone. That. It's gone.
Not every sector of the industry is in decline. The most successful boats fish only for the pelagic species, herring and mackerel. The pelagic sector is an example of the global potential of UK fishing. Their seasonal catches can end up in sushi bars in Tokyo or on the dinner tables of Moscow. It's midsummer, and Forever Grateful is hunting for herring off Cape Roth.
As well as keeping an eye on the sonars, the modern technology, you're always looking on the surface to see if there's a whale blowing or the gannets fishing.
The Scottish pelagic fleet consists of only 30 vessels. With crews earning 2 to 3 times the income of their whitefish colleagues, jobs are like gold dust. On the Forever Grateful, it's a family affair. Up on the bridge is Father Will White, his son-in-law, and Will Jr.
Is that a marquee over there? This is a mark now.
This is a mark of fish.
This is a mark of fish here, look. A very sharp mark, look. Over technology work. Come away, me lucky lads. Let's be having you. That's a better, eh?
Though the fleet may be small, the investment is huge.
Watch it.
To build and license a boat like this today would cost over £20 million. It's not always been good times. The present fleet has evolved out of its own crisis. By the late 70s, herring stocks had plummeted and a 5-year fishing ban was imposed.
About 20, 25 years ago, they closed the North Sea for herring, and we thought it was the end of the world. The whitefish sector was doing well at the time, and we thought the end of the world. But along came the mackerel, and the mackerels pulled us, like the pelagic fleet, out of the bayou.
Back in those days, fishing was seasonal, and boats alternated between whitefish and herring. But as fishing techniques evolved, the pelagic boats have become highly specialised.
Radio, it's a Whitehall.
A Whitehall.
And I'm off again.
The scale of the catch will seem awesome to many. However, it should be remembered that in 2003, the catching power of the fleet, compared to stock levels of herring, was considered to be well balanced. The scientists even recommended a major increase in quota for the North Sea.
That's the best bit.
The pressure's off a wee bit.
The Forever Grateful can carry over 600 tons of herring.
Well, let's just start at the pump, and we've got, I would think, a good 100 ton, at least in the bag.
I am redeemed. I am redeemed. Jesus loosed the chains of sin, set me free. Jesus loosed the chains of sin and set me free.
This is a row, a female. Brilliant. You like some?
At the present moment, the future is rosy, but it we live in so fickle a situation. This year, 2003, they've increased the herring quota by 40%. Maybe next year, with the stroke of a pen, they'll decrease it by maybe 30 or maybe 50%.
That's good.
Radio, 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 radio! Captain has on the table!
This is mercy. Blessing to our bodies and keep us in love for Jesus' sake. Amen. Right. Well, all right, this time.
Right.
Yet even in the most successful sector of Scottish fishing, there are real fears for the future as the European Union continues to grow.
The Spaniards will always beat the buck, or the foreign fleet will always beat the buck, another 10 countries coming in. Are we opening the door for any Tom, Dick or Harry to come in and benefit from our own grounds? The fishing communities, especially in the northeast, has been built up in fish, and we're going to be decimated by politicians that doesn't bother their backside about anything.
The final decision has been made. The bank has forced Sandy to decommission the Steadfast.
I'd never think this would happen, never. You just never think that would happen. A new boat, just 6 3/4 year old, would end up going to breaker's yard. You just kind of hardly believe that.
I mean, this is his last sail with the boat. I mean, it's quite sad, really, and it is. It's a totally different feeling him going to war with the boat the night as fit it usually is.
I don't think my dad's the kind of person to show much emotion outside. And probably I'm neither, so it'll be interesting to see how it pans out between the two of us over the next 2 days. My dad, to me, has been my skipper, my teacher, my dad, and probably one of my best pals. So much to thank him for that I wouldn't do it to his face, because I don't think he'd like me to do it, but I've never, ever regretted going to sea.
I'll see you later.
With this decommissioning, there's a lot of good men been put at work. I mean, really experienced guys, like my dad. To me, he's a brilliant fisherman. I think a lot of guys in Fraserburgh would agree with that. And he's been stolen out of the industry, which is a great shame, because I think he's a lot of knowledge to pass down to younger guys.
Give your phone, right? When I go in, all right? I love you, all right? Good, be good. See you later.
Every time they leave a harbour, there's always that fear and there's always that dread. You know, are they going to return home safely to us? You've always got that in the back of your mind.
It's the way of our life. Mm. It's just something that's there. You know they're out there, you know they'll do whatever they can to make themselves safe, and you try not to worry too much about it.
If you were to sit and worry about every storm that we personally seen in the northeast of Scotland, then you'd be a nervous wreck.
Hard trying to keep your feet. It's the boat rolling and things. It's been quite difficult. It's getting there, struggling.
It's day one on the Steadfast's voyage to Denmark. Weather permitting, the trip should take 51 hours.
Hello, Sandy.
On board to help is Sandy's son-in-law, Keith.
Back at 7.
Like a day, is it?
It's not bad. Like, it's all right.
It's good.
With the imminent loss of the Steadfast from the family, Xander has decided to quit fishing. However, the lure of the sea is just too strong.
This is Fortis oil field. This is what I'm going to be doing after we get clear with this boat. I'm going to be in one of these standby vessels, waiting to respond to emergencies that could happen. Chase fishing boats away, just hoping that the standby job is going to provide me with the same excitement, which I hope it will.
The core of the crisis in the whitefish sector centres on how many fish are in the sea. The politicians listen to the scientists. The fishermen fiercely dispute their figures. Hunter against conservationist, daily experience versus an inexact science. Before joining Europe, fishermen lived in the much simpler market of supply and demand. With the advent of the Common Fisheries Policy in the early 70s, there came the wonder world of guaranteed minimum prices for your fish and grants to build boats. As overfishing became rife and fears grew for stock levels, the tide turned. The good times were over. Today, each boat belongs to an association that is given a total allowable catch for the year. If too much is caught too early, the year's end brings slim pickings.
I'll just show you something here. This is my quota that I got from a producer organisation the end of last month. Now, I've got cod here at 8 boxes, haddock here at 17 boxes, and I've got whitings here at 17 boxes. If you're lucky, that would net you about, coming up away, £1,600 for your month. That's just utter ridiculous. You could catch that in one haul, no problem. If we weren't decommissioning this boat, I'd be faced with landing blackfish every trip.
With quotas down 70% in the last decade, anyone catching beyond their quota is faced with a stark choice. To be legal, they must either dump the excess at sea, anathema to a hunter, or earn less by having to pay to rent quota from another skipper. Their other choice is to run the gauntlet of the fisheries officers and land blackfish. The conspiratorial nature of landing blackfish was initially seen as exciting, but many skippers now admit to feeling criminalised, yet continue to do it as fish prices and their incomes drop.
We haven't landed blackfish this year at all. Just once there wasn't a lot. We have been having to rent our fish, but now there's hardly any fish to rent, so there's no way forward for me this year anyhow. But this just makes me feel like a criminal. The fishery officers is just waiting for you whenever you come in. We've been made to lie. We've been made to cheat. They've put us in this position.
In order to earn a living or to be greedy?
Oh, certainly not greedy, no.
The media attention that the Crusaders have generated has had an unexpected twist. They've been nominated for the Great Scott Awards in Glasgow.
Some of them coming in with their ball gowns and you think, oh my God, are we going to fit in?
Cool!
Autographs.
Behave yourself.
I kind of fit my fog push in. Are you nervous?
Mm-hmm. Was it Crusade for Cod's sake?
Crusade for Cod's sake. Look at us, gonna what doing to a social evening, right? And we've got all this cod crusade and stuff. This is what we're going to shove underneath our politicians' noses. In the words of Shania Twain, let's go, girls. I think we're supposed to be in here. We're one of the 10 finalists.
Sorry?
I think we're supposed to be in here. One of the 10 finalists.
All right.
One of the 10 finalists. Well, nobody said the finalists are in, but we'll certainly let you in anyway, ladies.
Right.
Fishing SOS.
Yes.
What, is fishing in danger?
Yes, very much so.
Is it?
Yes.
Oh, it's not. Is that cherry filled
kettle? We've had enough of Brussels dictations. Now we want to go for national control.
Pleased to meet you. I'm Carol McDonald, Cod Crusader.
Oh, yes. Hi, nice to meet you.
Hello. Well,
hi, how are you? So, are you getting an award?
Yes, well, we've been nominated for the final 10.
My lords, ladies and gentlemen, we ask you please to take your seats as this evening's proceedings are about to commence.
Though they missed the top award, the Crusaders have won priceless publicity.
I thought it was great.
really thought it was great. They're getting recognised at last for the efforts. And I was invited as well, so I didn't get to the high-profile thing, so I was pretty sick about that. She's surprised me in a lot of ways, like, a lot of ways. She's got some bottle.
When I was about 12, 13 years old, my father was a big influence. He learned me a lot at that early age. He used to put me in the forward part of the boat and I used to catch my own fish, pulling up a cod bigger than myself from 30, 40 fathoms was quite exciting, I could tell you. I would say that intrigued me to go out the fishing at the early stage. I was never going to tell him about a decommissioning, because he hadn't very long to live at that time, so I wasn't going to tell him, but when he asked what I was doing, I just had to tell him. The last week of my father's life, he was just sort of lying in his pillow side on, and he wouldn't have really lift his head. You know, he just, like, lay there and uninterested, and all of a sudden, when I mentioned decommissioning, especially scrapping the boat, his head turns up and he just looks at my face with great wide-open eyes, you know, staring up. His mouth was wide open. It was amazing, because he hadn't done that, actually, for a whole week. So it must have hurt him a lot. Quite a lot, I think.
The heritage, well, our days are long gone, again. Boys falling on for their fathers now, but a lot of boys are just realising it's a shit job. Skippers are seeing that the job's knackered again, so they're sailing up their boats and putting their loons into something else. It's not a job, it's an existence. I didn't enjoy it now. Once upon a time I would have enjoyed it, but just every week's a thought. Bigger thought is that it's going to sea, then coming back, then getting into the office to get your pay. To see if you've knocked your pan in for. And getting up the road and seeing her face, my face, it's just soul destroying, especially lately.
Cod Crusaders started off as sparklers, ended up being rockets, but they didn't have put a bang up the industry.
Happy birthday.
It's the first anniversary of the Cod Crusaders.
Cod children. It's Roddy. No, it's okay.
There's no escape from the pressure as they organise their visit to the European Fisheries Summit in Brussels.
Keep the faith. Isn't that good? It's good.
But for Carol, there are more immediate problems closer to home.
See you later. Bye.
It's not the same woman I married 13 years ago. She's not so reliant on me now. She's never off a phone, she's never in. She's fighting for a fishing, but nobody's subsidising her. I'm here to subsidise it with the money that I ain't got. She sees light in the tunnel, I'll let her be. She can see it. She'll maybe see it herself. I don't again. From 8 o'clock in the morning till 7 o'clock at night, this phone starts ringing. I would do undies he then. I'm £600 every quarter for a phone bill. I want to see for 10 days, 20 days, and you come here and you want a bit of peace. I'm back or either way. Just take time for our family as well.
Okay, fair enough. I've had my ups and downs with the family, but I think we've got our shells now onto an even keel that I'm just so hell-bent. Again, this is where the selfishness comes into it. I'm just so hell-bent in achieving more than what we've achieved. I think that's maybe a wee bit greedy, but I'm not satisfied just yet. I'm not gonna want to throw away my family life because I mean, they'll always be there for me. I hope. for the Cod Crusaders, maybe when I be.
I don't think we'd ever come to divorce. Like it's just getting over this hurdle at the moment. To see if, just to her step back, hey, look, that's fine, that's what's happening here. I'll try and sort that bit of her. Then still get on with her Cod Crusading. That's great. Okay. But as long as there's time here for us, that's all I'm asking. Not much, not a lot. Just enough for the bairns, especially.
Right. It's my turn to shock the pan. Chicken breast wrapped in bacon in a cheese food slice. I think there's muggle tricks that Jamie Oliver can teach me.
With the Danish coast just over the horizon, it's the last evening on the Steadfast.
They always say that boats are girls. She's a great boat. She's coming on well. Her engine's in. And it's absolutely fabulous. It was something that, it's memories that I'll always have in the back of my head. And I enjoyed every single minute of watching her take shape. It was mine. Well, not mine, but my family's and partly mine. And I think you always put a little bit of self into your boat. This boat really tells a lot about us. It tells a story, and that story is a way to be scrapped.
Really, this boat has become a part of me, in a sense. It's been a big part of my life. So tomorrow, that's where it'll surround, not in the investment, not in the money. Not so much as the end of a dream, it's the end of a part of my life. It's the end of a big part of my life. We'll just have to get over it.
It's December 2003 in Brussels, the time of year when the European fisheries ministers come together to haggle over their individual fishing rights. This is the moment when the negotiating skills of each nation are brought to the table. Carol and Morag are in town for the second year, hoping to make their mark.
Last year, we were naive, we were just learning the system, and I just said to Morag, would you have thought that this time last year that we would be thinking, well, maybe next year we'll be in Brussels on the negotiation team? And she says, no.
Also in town are delegates from other fishing groups. From the Scottish Fishermen's Federation, Davy Milne brings added emotion as, during the very week of the talks, his boat is also in Denmark, waiting to be destroyed.
Was it 21.6?
The delegates share a sense of frustration and impotence as the future of their industry is bargained for by ministers behind closed doors.
Well, that's just the position our fishing industry is in. You rely on your representation. And if your representation is not strong, then we're not strong. Have to hope Mr. Bradshaw is very good.
Remember that for Annex 17, we've had 15 days.
The key role for delegates is trying to advise and influence their ministers during a break in the talks. Carol and Morag are invited to a briefing session with UK Fisheries Minister Ben Bradshaw, the man who must deliver for Britain.
Are we being a bit complacent on this and assuming you can get it, or how confident are you
that... I wouldn't assume we can get anything. I wouldn't assume we can get anything until we've got it.
How is the decommissioning going to actually sort of work, and how are we going to explain it?
There are pluses and minuses of any particular length.
Our ministers are very, very weak men, and they're either weak or they just don't want to do anything about it.
Rather than shorter periods.
I'm going to have to go.
They don't have the emotion that these fishermen feel.
See you later.
They can't possibly feel the emotion and the heartbreak that's actually felt within these communities.
It's just a graveyard.
It's a dump, isn't it?
Very eerie. It's very strange. Strange feeling. Time of morning as well. That's what Mr. Fischler and the European Commission and we're on the Fisheries Minister's think of Fraserburgh and Peterhead and Aberdeen. That pile of rubbish, that's what they think of us. Well, I think that's what we think of them.
Even as the boat ties up, there are bargain hunters waiting to pounce. First aboard, an Icelandic fisherman.
I'm looking for an engine. I can't possibly...
Oh, you're looking for an engine?
Okay, but I can...
Will this engine maybe be good for that boat?
It's a similar size of boat.
Yeah, your size, yeah. This is a good engine.
Yeah.
It's a good engine. I'm just glad I'm not going to be here to see it cut up. I'm glad I am not going to be here to see it cut in pieces.
I can understand.
Hello?
Next, two Dutchmen in search of electronics.
Vultures flying above you, waiting to peck at the scraps. Aye, sure, Dad.
Maybe a bit interesting that radar.
They'll sell things in no time.
Oh, it's fearsome.
Aye, aye. Just in no time at all.
I hope he does take the radar because it's buggered.
As the talks drag on, frustrated delegates meet and share their grievances.
Dictatorial de la Commission.
To be quite honest, I think what we're going to see is a delivery package has been devised a few weeks ago, and what we're actually witnessing is just the fine tuning of it.
Behaved in a dictatorial fashion, and we'll continue.
A week today is Christmas, and where are we? We're actually sitting like the rest of the other idiots, waiting just to be the fished ones told. That's the deal done, this is what you're getting.
It is the last night of the Brussels talks. The pressure builds for a final agreement. Weary after days of negotiation, the ministers talk through the night. Just after dawn, word comes out that they have reached a compromise. But the word is not good.
It's the same thing again. It looks as though we are going to come out with the worst deal again for being the most conservative in the EU.
Bringing substance to the rumours, Ben Bradshaw arrives to reveal his deal.
I think it's a good deal for the UK. I'll say a bit more about it later. Thanks.
With him is Ross Finney, Scottish Fisheries Minister.
We've got a long-term cod recovery plan for the first time in the European Union, which I believe will allow cod to recover. It won't happen overnight, but it will happen year on year. And at the same time, we have maximised our fishing opportunities on those stocks that are doing well. So those communities that depend on fishing for a livelihood will be able to survive and earn enough money to keep going to take advantage of the cod when it does recover.
That is simply unworkable, because you're going to lose a huge increase in our quota, but 25%
into that point. It clearly can be taken in the major area for catching fish.
We came away with almost everything that was on our priority list, and I don't think there's any other country that could tell you honestly that they did that.
It's ridiculous. It's absolutely ridiculous. I'm a fisherman. I've spent 30 years to see. There are no cod in that area.
I think it's a better balanced outcome.
There's no way the fishermen will survive in this. It's impossible. Like.
But I think the really positive aspect is that we've taken forward some of the ideas which the industry themselves were promoting. This whole question of getting a more spatial distribution.
Say we're working at Charlie, say we're working at Doona Power or whatever, right? We have to come on here, we have to steam 120 mile, 130 mile to get a permit, to get back out, to shift 2 mile.
Who the fuck derived that?
There are prospects of building on this and therefore seeing a progressive improvement in the lot of our fishermen.
The French seem to get to go into talks and they tell them what they want. Our ministers seem to lie back. To them, this is a major achievement, the way Mr. Bradshaw's body language was today.
Well, I'd certainly rather be doing something else than the week before Christmas spending 24 hours all night negotiating in Brussels.
It's just ridiculous, honestly.
To be quite honest, I'm in a state of disbelief because we've actually seen now how things is conducted within the Commission. There's no point in getting, you know, a big quota when you've got no days to go and catch it. We're being shafted.
Back in Denmark, Sandy and Xander must finally leave the Steadfast.
I could stop the main engine from here. You just that button.
It's only there.
Yeah, look, I'll show you. You'll see it. You just keep it pressed. I'll leave it as it is, and you just press that button, and
we take care of it.
Okay, that's fine. Yeah. Good.
Bye-bye. Okay, bye. That's it, Dad.
That's something the kind of tigawa. The kind of tigawa, the knowledge you've got.
It's something I'll never ever forget. Since that pride I had. Taking her out of Peterhead for the first time. We kind of decommission that. Kind of decommission and take away memories. It's not right.
They left her just as they had lived in her. Disillusioned by Brussels, the Cod Crusaders have decided that their future now lies in campaigning to take the British fleet out of the common fisheries policy.
To be quite honest, I do think that that day will come, and I just hope that we're still here to witness it. If national control, or should I say when we get national control, I would say it's quite a lot of perseverance through ourselves as maybe it's going to achieve it. It's no longer a dream, it is going to become reality.
And you'll be there?
I'll be there.
Over there to fly the flag the day it happens, yep. Definitely.
She's put as much work, blood and sweat into her. There's just no way that I would take that away from her. It's long to have a life, it's been fighting for a few years yet. So I've just put away it. There's just no way I'd take a ticket away for you. No way, I couldn't live with myself. Whether I liked it or not.
Back in Denmark, there's an incredible sting in the tale of the Steadfast. Even though Brussels demands that her hull be destroyed, other parts can be sold off. Her wheelhouse, engine and electronics have been sold, almost unbelievably, to fishermen from Thailand. They'll ship each bit home and reassemble it on another hull. They wanted to buy the complete vessel and just cannot understand the waste of a good ship in perfect condition.
Very sad thing, you know, to be the either owner or the skipper with, I mean, their life it on the vessel, and to see the vessel torn apart like this, it, I think we cannot describe how sad it is.
Since I've been home, I mean, every night nearly I go to my bed, I'm thinking about fish. I remember my father saying something about fish fever, so I think that's maybe what it's like.
Let's go to Wanu, do my month at a standby, to the best of my ability, get paid for it, and then come back to this guy. And someday I'll be able to pass on a story to him. Yeah?
I said earlier on I wouldn't go back, but if it's in my blood, I'll maybe just go back.
If something good had come out of it, we'd be able to turn around and say, well, at least it was for something, but it isn't. It's been in vain because absolutely nothing good has come out of it. The fishing isn't in a better state. The fishermen haven't gotten a better deal because our boat's been scrapped. You just feel shafted, really, and that's just where it comes to now.
In the last 4 years, Scotland's whitefish fleet has been decimated. The fishermen believe their livelihood is being sacrificed through political neglect, and fear theirs will be another UK industry consigned to museum and memory.
I mean, if you get a big haul of cod aboard, I mean, it's tremendously exciting. I mean, I've just seen myself just jumping into the fish hopper when there's cod there, and just jumping in and getting in there and kissing them and hugging them, just really excited. I mean, the crew says, look at him. Can I mean, if you get a haul of cod, it's a lot of money, right enough, but say the money you're thinking at the time, it's just a fish, they're just a beautiful fish.